my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Good morning, and once again, on behalf of your family here at United Baptist Church, we welcome you to our worship service this morning. I don't know if you're listening on the radio or if you are viewing via our website. Either way, we are just tickled pink that you are with us here this morning. Oh my goodness, and I don't even know why I use that word tickled pink, but we are. Oh, and I just, if I forget, sometimes I apologize, but I just am always amazed at the folks down at the radio station and the folks here at United Baptist that work so hard and diligently to bring you this broadcast or to bring you this video that you are watching. There is truly a lot of work that goes into it, and it's all behind the scenes. And just if you happen to run across either one of the radio station folks or the folks here at the church that put this together, let them know that you are grateful for the work that they put in. Ah, it is truly amazing. Our joke for this morning, from the portion of the joke book, The Daily Grind. And it goes like this. I don't mind going to work every day. It's the sitting around for 8 hours waiting to go home that I can't stand. Oh, goodness. Oh, it's been a while, but I can remember graduating with my bachelor's degree. In my case, the graduation ceremony was actually a couple of weeks before our classes actually ended, but because we were within just a couple of weeks of completing those classes, the school allowed us to walk in the graduation ceremony. We could go through all of the motions, but until we successfully completed our studies, we would not receive our diploma. There were those in our class that thought taking part in the graduation ceremony was a waste of time. And there were some that had to drive a considerable distance to get there on a weekend, and they just decided that they would not participate. But I wanted to go to enjoy the experience, to celebrate the accomplishment, and yes, for myself, but also to rejoice with those folks that had worked so hard and dedicated themselves, my friends and my family, to filling in when I couldn't do it because of my schoolwork and all of those things. They sacrificed so much that I could be here at this particular point in time. And so I wanted to rejoice with them as a part of this ceremony. And the ceremony itself was just like all other graduation ceremonies, right? Introductions were made, speeches were presented, and yet the most memorable part and why all were there gathered that day was to hear my name called and to get to walk across that stage to receive the diploma amongst the cheers of all our loved ones in the audience. Oh, great stuff, great stuff. Now, I was able to complete the rest of my class, and in an undergraduate degree, all right, the last night of class was always the class final, that final test that you had to take in order to complete that course. And this particular test, as I was thinking about it, it determined not only my final grade for that particular class, but it was also whether or not I was going to receive that diploma or not and actually graduate. Oh, the professor of that particular class, knowing full well what the situation was of us that were taking the class, offered for us to grade the test that very evening if we was willing to wait around and wait for them to grade it. And of course I did. I wanted to know. And I passed the test and completed my degree, and within a couple of weeks I received in the mail my diploma. And as satisfying as getting that in the mail, that diploma, as satisfying as that was, one of the things I remember most is that next morning, right after that final test that I took, that final test was done, and I knew that I had passed. That next morning, I had that joyous thought. I don't have any more tests to take. Yes! I don't even have to study for another test. Oh, what a great feeling. But I later did return back to school to get my master's degree, but as we all know, master's program are not about information collection and accumulation and testing our knowledge over that information, but rather a master's program is more research and developing our personal outreach. It's in writing papers and presenting our view of certain situations. It's not about tests. But even at that, I have come to realize over the course of the years that we are all continually being tested. Oh, it's not about bookwork anymore, no, but a testing that comes about looking at our character and our motivation. Oh, my goodness, we continue to be tested throughout our lives. Our scripture this morning, as we will look at that a little bit more in detail, comes in Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1. We're going to look at verses 9 through 15. Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. And here we read, "At that time Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, 'You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased.' At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put into prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. 'The time has come,' he said. 'The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news.'" Let us pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, again, I thank you for this glorious day that you have blessed us with. And Lord, it's not the circumstances and situations we find ourselves in that make it a glorious day. It's not particularly the weather or any other things that we could think, but it is a glorious day because you are with us each and every moment of it. You are here with us during those good times. You are with us during the sad and the trying times. You never leave our side. There is never a time that we are all alone. Father, thank you. And I just pray that you'd be with us here and now to open our hearts and our minds to your message for us here today. Speak your words into our very souls, Lord. May it change us to the degree that you would have it, Lord, to be more and more like Jesus. Thank you, Father. And I would just pray here and now, Lord, that you would take the words of my mouth and that you would take the meditations of all of our hearts and that you would make them acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Today is the first Sunday of Lent. Growing up, I grew up in a non-liturgical church. As a child, I didn't have a clue what Lent actually was. I had heard of it, but only through some of my Catholic friends that lived on the block with us. It was something that the Catholics did that they had to do in their church, not ours. I grew up Baptist. We didn't have anything to do with Lent or anything like that. Those other Catholic kids, they had to do special stuff like eat fish on Fridays, right? And they even had to speak about giving up something for Lent. I wasn't about to give up anything. No, sir. However, as I have become more aware of the meaning behind these dedicated times like Lent here before Easter or Advent before Christmas, I realize that there is value, definite value in the preparation that these times allow us to have. Preparing ourselves for the upcoming celebration. And while we are not liturgical in our style of worship here, we can realize the benefits that these times can bring to our worship and to our celebration itself. Lent is the 6 weeks of preparing our hearts to celebrate one of the most impactful events in all of time and history. The celebration of Easter, the event of proclamation that Jesus is Lord by his resurrection from the dead. We have opportunities to help us all along the way. There are Lenten devotionals. There are things that you can pull up on your cell phone, apps that can help us do those things of Lent to prepare our hearts. Oh, my goodness. And they are helpful. I would suggest that if you have not done anything along those lines, this would be a great year to give it a try. But anyway, this morning we read from the Gospel of Mark, the first chapter in Mark, in fact. And we recognize right off the bat that Mark's Gospel does not include an account of Jesus' birth. Only Matthew and Luke give us the events surrounding his birth. Here in Mark, after a short introduction of John the Baptist, Mark jumps right in to Jesus' ministry. And here in verse 9 of the first chapter, we find Jesus' baptism. Now, yes, a couple of weeks ago, you'll remember with me, we took a little bit more deep, in-depth look at that particular baptism. And we realized that Jesus' baptism was not for repentance or even for forgiveness of sin. It was the starting point for Jesus' earthly ministry. It was his proclamation that he was leaving his other life and beginning his ministry here on this earth. Mark goes on to tell us that after his baptism, Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit out into the wilderness. Just a little side note here, okay? This is another event and mention of the presence of the Holy Spirit even before Pentecost. All those that believe that the Spirit only came at Pentecost and is with us now, here's another one of the times when the Spirit was with us. But anyway, we remember that when Jesus was in that desert for 40 days, as we were told, Satan tempted him. Satan tested Jesus. The Gospels of Matthew and Luke, both chapter 4s of those two respective Gospels, tell the specific temptations that Satan presented to Jesus, trying to get Jesus to submit to these temptations. But here in Mark, we are just told that Jesus was tempted. Jesus was tested. We know that these temptations were each designed so that Jesus would not have to go through all of the pain and the suffering that was lying ahead of him if he continued in God's plan. And Jesus knew that. And yet, with each temptation that Satan presented to Jesus, Jesus refuted his shortcut by quoting Scripture. Not once did Jesus hesitate. Not once did Jesus yield. Jesus was tested. Oh, they were tests that carried a whole lot more consequences than just the passing of a college course or even the passing of a degree program. Still, Jesus was tested. Each and every test, Jesus passed with perfection. He passed with perfection. With his success on each and every one, I believe he has given us an example to follow. When we find ourselves faced in a situation that we need to make a decision on how to proceed, and we are not sure what is the best way to go, we may even find ourselves in a predicament. Now, I love the definition of a predicament, which is trying to make a good decision between two bad choices. Okay? But we find ourselves saying, what do we do? First and foremost, we pray. Ask for God's direction. Too often, I believe, prayer is put at the end of our process, all right? It's the caboose at the end of the train. When we have tried everything we can think of, when we've done everything that we can do, oh, well, we need to pray about it then. No. Prayer needs to be up with the locomotive at the front of the train. The first thing that we do, we pray for God's direction. After we pray for God's direction, then we look to the scriptures. Jesus refuted Satan's temptations with scriptures. We too can look to the scriptures. Now, our specific issue may not be found exactly in the scriptures, but we can find there guidance and direction. The Word of God never, never, never contradicts itself. If we are facing a decision that would compromise or even contradict the scripture, then we know that that is not a good course of action to follow. Or if we cannot even determine through scripture, then we can also seek the help of godly counsel, a close Christian friend that can help us through the possibilities and may even be able to, through an experience that they have been through, provide some additional insight and direction. And we've prayed, we've looked at the scriptures, we've asked a Christian brother or sister, and we're still not sure. I think here we need to take a step back and let that decision rest. Pray that God will lead you in the right way. Too many times, I believe when we feel like we are pressured into making a choice right then and right there, we tend to make those decisions in haste. And then we realize later that we may have not made the best decision. Okay? Whenever we feel pressure, and if we can let it rest, we let it rest and continue to let God speak to us. Jesus, when he was tested, passed the test. And he provided an example that we can follow when we are tested. And I want to go on to the next step. As we was reading that scripture in verses 14 and 15 of Mark chapter 1, Jesus began proclaiming the good news of God. After he was tested, he began proclaiming the good news of God. What is that good news? What is the good news of God? And the good news is simply that God loves everyone and desires a personal relationship with each and every person. And he has done everything to make it happen. Jesus' message after that temptation and passing that test, after being baptized, after his public ministry's beginning, he begins with what has already been told by those that have gone before him. It was no different than what had been spoken before. Even John the Baptist, in verse 15, we find Jesus say, "Repent and believe the good news." Jesus' message of repentance and belief is the same, coming, of course, from God's one and only Son. But the message was the same. Satan tempted Jesus with some shortcuts and imitations. Jesus' message is consistent, that we must turn from our wicked ways. We must recognize that we cannot do it on our own. We must realize that we need Jesus. We need him, and we need to believe in him. When we do that, we will pass our test and become his children forever. forever his child. Not just after we pass from this life, but even in the here and now, we are his children and he is with us. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we realize that we are daily tested, sometimes hourly tested, sometimes moment by moment tested. But God, as long as our eyes are upon you, we can. You provide the means to pass those tests. You provide the opportunity to pray. You provide the scripture that we need. You provide the Christian counsel that is required. And yes, you even provide the time that we can set that decision aside and to allow you to speak to our hearts in more detail. Thank you, Father. And gracious God, I thank you for your message for us here today. And Lord, as we come before you now, we come before you with our hearts and our minds. But we also come before you with our voices, Lord, as in unison we pray that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.